Anyway, so I'm holding in my hand Dave Mustaine's new book that came out yesterday.
Wait, I have to give you tweezers so that you turn the pages.
Oh, come on.
Tweezers.
You want to turn the pages for me? Come over here. You can do that. We'll hold it. We'll put it behind glass, and you could reach in, like with those glove things, like on the handle of plutonium.
Yeah.
You can do that. You want to do that? Okay, hold on. Let me go into the air locker. Airlock.
Right. Why are the pages already stuck together?
No, it was rubbing it on her cuckoo, she said before.
This is my late night entertainment.
You use your lips to turn the pages?
By the way, Noah pointed out to me that the very first two words in this book are James Hetfield. And I thought
Seriously.
She was kidding, but I went to the introduction and it starts off, James Hetfield, who used to be one of my best friends, as close as a brother, once observed with some incredulity that I must have been born with a horseshoe up my ass. That's how lucky I've been. Well, it's probably true, because he's been in rehab like 59 days, right? 59 times, I should say. So, I'm just going to read
for
some of these ridiculous things in here. Like, I opened the page, the book randomly, and I wind up with the, actually wound up completely by accident on the page where James Hetfield kicks his dog. Totally not bullshitting.
Are you serious?
Yes, the page 66.
Can you read it?
You want to hear this story? All right, I'm going to read this like Dave Mustaine. Prior to the formation of Metallica, I bought a couple of dogs to dissuade people from breaking into my house, which had happened on occasion in part because of my business interests, quote unquote.
did he write that in the book?
Because I started reading the book last night on the train.
Yes.
And just reading it in my normal voice that's in my head didn't suffice. So I started reading it as if you were reading it, and it made it so much better.
You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to record this as an audiobook for you.
Perfect.
Can we sell it on the site? Is that going to do it?
Okay. These were formidable pups, Staffordshire Terriers, which are similar to pit bulls, crossbred with Rhodesian Ridgebacks. And they quite naturally scared the shit out of most people. But they were also very affectionate and loyal, and I cared for them immensely. When I traveled to Ron McGovney, when I traveled to Ron's house for rehearsal or to a gig, I usually leave them behind to protect the house. Sometimes one of the dogs would keep me company. One day in the summer of 1982, I drove to rehearsal, and when I let the dog out of the car, she began running around. Dogs do that when they've been cooped up for a while. Thanks,
yeah.
Dr. Dave Mustaine.
So educational.
Dave Mustaine, dog whisperer.
At some point, I said that already. Okay, yeah. At some point, the female jumped up on the front quarter panel of Ron's car, a beautiful Pontiac GTO, prompting James to give the dog a hard kick across its chest. The dog, she was still just a puppy, let out a yelp and scampered away.
Aww.
And I went nuts. What are you doing? Now I gotta do James's voice.
Ginger rage.
She's scratching the car, man. Yeah, James said. As if that was an acceptable excuse for kicking a dog. Fuck you, I said. No, he actually wrote fuck you. Like, he's writing it and remembering it now. Fuck you. Like,
oh, yeah, that's
mad.
When I said fuck you.
The actual...
No, he wrote all of these, like, in his diary at the end of the day.
Really? It seems like...
So.
Did he actually write this, though?
The way it's written, like, really seems like it.
Hey,
like,
Noah, fuck you. I'm trying to read my book here.
Okay.
Is this, like, written by Dave Mustaine and, you know, as told to somebody? Or
look on the side of the...
It just
the,
says
the
Dave
spine.
Mustaine. Oh, with Joe Layden.
Yeah.
Ah, so he didn't really write. Maybe this didn't happen. Here we go. The actual fight didn't happen right there. They call it a hang fire. Like when there's an unexpected delay between the trigger of a gun being pulled and the actual discharge of the weapon. I know, because I shoot guns a lot, people.
That's
you know,
it.
No. I added that. Sorry, Dave.
That was a footnote.
You know it's coming and there's no stopping it. It's just a matter of time. James and I alternately cursed at each other. Fuck you! Fuck you! Fuck you! Fuck you!
There it is. That's
how I know about guns. I have one in my pocket.
But let me skip ahead. Oh, okay.
You keep talking like that, and I'm gonna punch you in the mouth, I said. Fuck off! Yeah!
I have to add yeah at the end of every joke.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah! In the middle of this exchange, Ron walked out of the bathroom and into the living room. He and James went way back. And despite the fact that James often treated him like shit, Ron instinctively defended his friend.
I don't know how to do a Ron McGovney voice, so I'm just going to say... No one knows.
Your usual voice.
Yeah. You hit him, you'll have to hit me. You hit him, you'll have to hit me first.
Miss Thing.
Shut up, Ron, and sit the fuck down, I said. And then James jumped to Ron's defense. You touch him, you're going to have to hit me first. Yeah. Jesus, I thought. I think in my voice, too. See? What is this? Some kind of fucking game show? I realized I would have to make a decision. Okay, you win.
Wow, that's kind of a pussy decision. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I screwed up. Yeah, Dave's telling a better story than me.
You win, I said, and with that, I threw a right cross that landed flush against James's face, turning his mouth into a pile of bloody chiclets.
What a metaphor. That's great. He's
saying James had to feel his big teeth.
No, he had chiclets in his mouth.
Oh.
He was eating chiclets. No, I'm eating chiclets right now. Yeah. Got bad breath. Ooh. Yeah. To my surprise, Ron immediately jumped on my back. Reflexively, I gave him a hip toss.
He's in the WWE. I got a great... Someone in the chat said Chitalica. If he remembered that incident, that would have been the name of the band.
A few people are saying, get to the part where Dave says he's gay.
Yes!
Right after that, I realized I was gay. He flew across the room and landed on an entertainment center, sending shards of particle board all over the place.
Imagine like what an entertainment center was in 19 whatever this yeah. was. It's probably like 9,000 pounds. Probably hurts a lot more than now. Oh, here you go. And destroying the old Pong video game hooked up to the TV.
The fight might...
He had an Xbox 2.
The fight might have gone on longer if not for the presence of my friend and martial arts training partner, Rick Solis, who quickly intervened.
JCVD.
I was right there by his side. I brought a woman, a bitch, for him to practice sparring on.
I was enraged, ready to kill both Ron and James, when Rick came up from behind and grabbed my elbow. That piece of shit.
No, I added that part, so.
Pinching the ulnar nerve and rendering me incapacitated.
He gave him the fucking Vulcan death grip.
We stood there together for a moment, seeing nothing.
Well, he was incapacitated by the Vulcan death grip.
When suddenly James began screaming at me. You're out of the band! Get the fuck out of here! Yeah! Ooh!
Yeah!
You're not in the band anymore! No! Oh. Ron was yelling, too. Lars, meanwhile, was in the bathroom watching people do coke.
No, I'm kidding.
Lars, meanwhile, was standing in a corner just sort of twirling his hair and trying unsuccessfully to mediate a settlement.
Come on, man. I don't want it to end this way. I obviously.
Why is he black?
I don't know. That was just my regular voice. So my regular
why
voice.
Why are you black?
My regular voice is black. I don't know why. Everyone thinks I'm black.
You know, that's funny because I just got a text from Sid and he said, tell Darren to be less ethnic and tell Sean to be more ethnic.
So I am just devoid of ethnicity.
Wait, my Mustaine voice is black too?
Yes.
Did that really come through?
Well, before the music break.
I was watching BET and drinking a Colt 45.
Okay, so Mustaine said, "Fuck you, I quit." And James said, "Good, fuck you too." That's the end of that chapter. So,
Wow, that was amazing.
I just want to say thank you, Dave, for writing this book, because you just filled one segment on every show for the next year and a half.
Wait, I thought you were going to be reading this at the Barnes & Noble on Saturday.
Yeah, I'm going to wear a blonde wig and just lose about 97 pounds and have people think
go up to him and be like, "Hello, man. You
hate the real me." I'll go there with a heroin needle hanging out of my arm and they'll think it's him.
I'm here for my reading.